And then in Exodus 10, it says there was a thick darkness in the land of Egypt. Egypt represents the world where Satan's ruler, but all the children of Israel, that represents the church, had light in their dwellings. So again, we are the light of the world, the church. And Philippians 2:15 says that no one can criticize you. How many know? Let me say this. People are going to criticize you. They're going to criticize you when you're doing bad. And here's the trippy part that I never got. They're going to criticize you when you serve God. They told me when I was in the world, you need to stop doing being a bad person and criticize me. This guy's this guy. Okay. Then I got saved and I got really radical for Jesus in church every day of the week. I was worshiping because I was getting free. And then they criticized me like I was getting too religious. So no matter what you do, they're going to criticize you. So you might as well serve God. And if you don't want to ever be criticized, don't do anything. And they're still going to criticize you for not doing anything. But here it says, don't let anyone criticize you in the way of live clean, innocent lives. So don't let them criticize you because you're not living right. But you need to shine like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverted people. So how many know we're in a world that's crooked, wicked, and perverted? And we need to be the light in the world. The church is the light of the world. So the city that God loves is the church. A lot of people grew up in church and they're kind of backslidden and they've seen a lot of things that were phony in church. So some of them are like, are you one of those phony Christians? They're going to realize after time you're not phony and it's not a fad. It's a real thing that God has changed your life. We're not preaching religion. We're preaching Jesus Christ. But here, these three scriptures let us know that we are the light of this world. We are the city of God, the house of God. I was in Colombia this week, and they call it La Casa de Dios. You know, it's like a house of God. I like the way that sounds, La Casa de Dios. You know, it's cool. But it's the house of God. So the city of God, that city that God loves, is the house of God. And so I'm going to talk to you about five things the church is, five things the church is. Number one, write this down. The church is a family, and it's a place of encouragement. In Hebrews 10:25, it says, let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. And in one translation says, let us not get in the habit of not coming to church. And, you know, during the pandemic, people got in the habit of not going to work. And I saw a statistic the other day that the real estate market for offices is really struggling, 50% vacancy over the U.S. because people got in the habit of not going to the work, going to work, and the pandemic ended, and they're like, everyone come back to work, and people are like, I ain't going back to work. Praise God. So they're working from home now, remotely. But they got in the habit of that. But I think some people got in the habit of that when it came to church. Like, I watch church online, and so I'm going to church. And church online is a blessing. Can I get an amen? I mean, YouTube, we invest a lot in YouTube, and I mean, it's a blessing. How many could say it's a blessing? But it's not like being here. It's not. Like, you could say all you want, watching Netflix and chill at your pad with a big old stereo and nice TV is like being in an IMAX theater, but it's not. How many know you got to watch Jurassic Park on an IMAX theater? It's just the way it is. It's the same thing with the house of God. I mean, it's good to watch online, and some people can't come. You know, I have family that they're in, convalescent, or they're in a being taken care of, or some people are in hospitals, or maybe in prison, and they can't come. So they watch online, and don't ask me how they get phones in prison. Come on, I don't know, but praise God, they're watching the Word. But they get in the habit of some people get in the habit of not coming to church. Some people can't, so online is their best option. But if you can get to church, you need to get your family and bring them to the house of God. That's part of serving God. That's part of setting like a tone with your children. Like, we're getting up, and they're like, man, it's not school. Why are we getting up early? Because we're going to the Casa de Dios. We're going to the house of God. And you get them all ready, get them all dressed up, and you come to church because you're setting a culture in your family. You're setting a standard in your family that on Sundays we honor God. We don't go golfing in the morning. We go to church. We don't go biking. We don't go to the beach. Now, I guess he missed vacation here and there. That's whatever. But I'm talking about consistently. You and your family and my family, we get up, we get ready, and we come to the house of God. That's a habit. That's where we bring our tithe, we bring our worship, we bring our service. This is the house of God. Because this is where a place goes on to say, of encouragement. Because when you come to the house of God, you can encourage one another. Especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. So he said, times are going to get tough. We're already in tough times. How many can agree? These times are tough. There's some stuff going on right now that's like, wow. But you know what? The house of God is meant to be a place where you come in, and if you're discouraged, you leave encouraged. You leave built up. One of the ways, like right now, you may be encouraging somebody. Right now, you don't even know it. You said, but Pastor, I didn't talk to nobody yet. It doesn't matter. By you coming here, maybe God is using you right now to speak to somebody, that if she can make it, I can make it. If he can make it, I can make it. Right now, right now, right now. I was about 6 months serving God, and I was in a rehab program. So I was the cleanest I'd ever been, living the best I'd ever lived. I was the happiest I'd ever been. But I was nervous, to be honest, because I was like, soon the program's going to end, and then I'm going to have more freedom, and I'm going to get a job and all these things. And man, am I going to be able to handle it? Will I be able to, you know, make it? Am I going to take the money and car and all, and am I going to go back to my old life? And I was nervous. Do I have what it takes? And I'll be honest, I didn't think I had what it took. The enemy was really working me. Like, you don't have it. You're not going to make it. You don't have what it takes. And I'm like, man, maybe I'm one of those guys that just do good for a while, but maybe I'm going to end up failing. And that fear of failure was resting on me. And I went to church discouraged. And I looked over at my friend, Robert Smith. I used to party with Robert back in the day. He actually took me to church. And Robert had graduated the program, and he was serving God, going to church. And I looked over at Robert, and he was worshiping God. He wasn't perfect like none of us were. But he was over there worshiping God and serving God. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me, said, if Robert can make it, you can make it. And right there, Robert encouraged me. And I made a decision. I'm going to make it. I want to encourage you today. You're going to make it. You're not going to go back to your old ways. You're not going back to your old life. That's over. You are a new creation. You're a child of God. And you and your family are going to serve God all the days of your life. The church is a family. Somebody shout, like, we're going to encourage each other. We need encouragement. I'm going to go deep on this one, okay? Number two, the church is a body for service and growth. The Bible says that, and I put here, allow God to raise you. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, that Jesus Christ, when he came out of the resurrection, he came out of the tomb, he said he ascended on high and gave gifts to men. So what does that mean? I mean, he gave the gift of the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, the teacher, and the evangelist. Those are the gifts of the offices of the church that God gave you. Those are gifts. So I would be considered a gift to you. So come on, somebody. No, I'm just kidding. That's good. Amen. So the Bible says, I'm a gift to you. It's what it says. And my role in your life is I'm supposed to equip you, and I'm supposed to train you. And all of our pastors and teachers that preach, our job is to train and equip you so you could do the work of ministry. And if we're all doing our part and we're all serving God, then the church begins to grow and the city begins to change and families get better and people get better. Come on. Oh, that's powerful. And so in order to serve God, you that's one of the ways you grow, but you have to be willing to grow to be used by God. God's not just going to use anybody. He wants you to grow. That's why we have family class. That's why we have groups, freedom family groups. That's why we have lifestyle of freedom. Why? So you could grow and change your lifestyle. So you could start living holy and live right and be used by God. Because God wants to use you in a mighty way. But you got to be tested. You got to be proven. So after I got saved, I couldn't really get too involved because I was still crazy a little bit. So God, you know, healed me and I grew and I said, God, I want to be used by you. And I had to change some areas of my life so I could be used by God. And I want to encourage you. It's time to grow. Don't be stagnant. Don't play it safe. I don't want to see you in a year from now at the same level. In a year from now, you need to be at another level with God. And then in a year, another level. And then another year, another level with God. Man, I feel the power of the Holy Spirit here right now. See, the Bible says in Psalms 110, verse 3, my people, your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power. A servant of God. It's so important that you volunteer. Like if you work 40 hours a week, you get paid $40 an hour, 20, 17. Some of you get paid 100 an hour. Some of you get paid 1,000 an hour. Doesn't matter. The fact is you go and you work and you get money. That's a blessing. No money, no honey. Somebody say amen. Come on now. Come on. Come on. My son Josh got a job and he went and got himself shoes and they were expensive shoes. And I said, man, just where you go ahead, brother. You worked. He bought his little shoes. Come on. But I say, you want them shoes? You got to work. And it's good because he's working. He's getting money. He's tithing. He's honoring God. He's learning to pay bills. And that's normal life. But when it comes to God's house, you don't get no money. So what does that do? Now you have to check your heart. Why am I ushering? Why am I volunteering? Why am I in the children? Why? Now you got to do it from your heart. You're not doing it for me because you'll get tired like that. You're not doing it for a leader. You're not doing it for your neighbor. No, you're serving God. It's important because that's where you get your heart checked. Why am I doing this? I'm getting up here. It's like I'm working. You are working, but you're working for God's house now so the church can grow and change a city. So God's will can be done. And it's true. Whatever a man sows, he will reap. Because they're not willing to grow so they can be used. They're not willing to change. They want to be part of a team. And you can't grow like that. So you got to be willing to change. You got to be. That's why people who serve at Freedom or any house of God, you're going to grow in your own career because you're going to learn to work with people. You're going to learn how to build teams. You're going to learn how to be part of a team. So it's very important that we serve God because the church is a body for service and growth and allow God to raise you in the house of God. Number three, the church is his bride and God blesses and protects his worshipers. In Hebrews 11:6, it says, he that comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, here is where you learn how to worship God. Not just with song, but a lifestyle where you worship God with all your heart and you diligently seek God. And that's a thing that has to be learned. You don't just wake up, I'm going to go after God. No, it's a lifestyle because how many times do I pray and I read and I spend hours with God and I don't feel much. I don't feel a lot right away sometimes. Sometimes I don't feel nothing. Sometimes the last thing I want to do is worship and pray. So I just don't want to do it. But I've learned to ignore my body. I've learned to tell my body, no, you're going to spend time with God. You're going to pray. You're going to read. Powerful. Like, I do my best. I probably like 80%, I'm pretty good with this, where every night before I go to bed, I go to my kids' room and I do like a 10-minute devotion with them. What am I teaching them? I'm teaching them how to diligently seek God. You know, and it's late. You think every time I go, ooh, I get to go do devotion. Nah, I want to go to bed. I want to chill. But no, I'm going to teach my children how to diligently seek God because I'm a worshiper. I want them to be worshipers. Clap, like you're going to train your children how to be worshipers. Because we're the body of Christ. We're the bride of Christ. In Jeremiah 30:19-20, it says, this is the house of God, thanksgiving. So when we come, how many know we come with thanksgiving? And the voice of those who make merry, that's praise and worship. And God said, if you come with the right heart, you come with the brokenness, you come with an attitude of gratitude, you don't come cocky with God, you don't come arrogant, you come with worship, you don't come late, you come on time. You don't go late to work. No, you come on time. And you come broken. You don't come like attitude, checking it out. What's all this? Come on, man. You're in the house of God. You got to come correct. You got to come broken. You got to come thankful. Like it's a privilege to be here. Some of us, let me be real. Some of us should be dead right now. I should have been dead a few times. But somehow God spared my life. car accidents, all kinds of craziness. But God spared me. I'm grateful. So I come grateful. They come with thanksgiving. You come with, we shouldn't have to like, come on, let's worship. No, you come ready to worship. You come ready to sing. You know, some of you are sports fans. If it was your favorite sports team, no one would have to tell you, hey, get excited and be, no, you'd be all fired up. When it comes to the house of God, we don't want to give it up. We don't want to give our praise. Come on, man. We got to be broken. We got to be grateful. We got to be thank you. Somebody give God a praise right now. For the bride of Christ. And forget what people are like, I'm insecure. No, it's not, you're not giving your neighbor praise. You're not clapping for your neighbor. You're not singing to your neighbor. You're not shouting to your neighbor. You're giving God praise. It's different level. Different level. Amen. And God said, if you come to my house correct, you come with thanksgiving and you come with the voice of Mary and melody and you come with singing and you come with the right heart, then I'm going to multiply them. I'm going to multiply you. How many want the spirit of multiplication to hit your life? I said, how many want the spirit of multiplication to hit your life? Multiply us, Lord, and they, watch me, and we will not diminish. We're not going backward. God said, I'm going to glorify you. I'm going to exalt you. I'm going to increase you. I'm going to promote you. I'm going to prosper you. I'm going to enlarge you. Come on, I'm going to put weight on your life. I'm going to put kabod on your life. I'm going to put excellence on your life. I'm going to put dignity on your life. I'm going to put favor on your life. Somebody ought to shout, give God up. I feel the anointing. That's why we're not ashamed. We're not ashamed to lift our voice. We're not ashamed to be loud in God's house. Maybe you're not used to it. You're like, oh my God, it's so loud here. But listen, let's not be hypocrites. We don't mind getting loud at the Laker game, and they're going to be good this year in Jesus' mighty name. Come on now. We got some good signings. We got our crew back. Or maybe you're even a Clipper fan. God bless you. You know what I mean? Praise the Lord. Whatever's clever, bro. No, I'm just kidding. Truth is, you know, we go to the games. I get excited. I like to watch boxing matches. There's going to be some boxing matches tomorrow or sparring, whatever. But I like that kind of stuff, you know? And I get excited and nothing wrong with it. I like football. Right now it's like purgatory of sports. There's no real good sports, you know? It's like, anyway, all right, I shouldn't have said that. Okay, whatever. There's no like, whatever. Okay, anyway, soccer, if you like soccer, soccer is good right now. But other than that, everything else is kind of But I like sports. I get excited. Why? Because I'm honoring. I'm excited. That's what you do. When it comes to God's house, it should be the most exciting, awesome, praise, loud, amazing. Discover why. I'm good. I'm barely getting there. You guys are early a little bit. But thank you. Because if they come up here, we're going to go somewhere and I'm going to teach a little bit. But here's the deal. The house of God, la casa de Dios, come on now. I've been in Colombia, man. But the house of God needs to be glorious with the bride of Christ. You worship God unashamed. Worship God boldly, uninhibited. Just give it up to God. Not limit God, not cap God with our praises. You know, the festival shouldn't be the most exciting place. That's why we lose a generation, because we tell them at the festival, yeah, you could dance and shout and be free. But in the house of God, you're going to be stiff and bored and no movement and no excitement. You'll lose a generation like that. That's why the church has lost a whole generation, because we grew up in boring churches and we didn't want anything part of that because it was funner in the club. But no, the devil's a liar. We're going to let the generations know the house of God is where the party's at. Somebody give God a shout of praise in here. Come on, young people. No. No, we're not going to let religion take a generation. And then God says, and you will not be small. Tell your neighbor, you're not going to stay small. In every area of your life, it's going to bloom is going to thrive, is going to prosper. For those that are planted in the house of God shall flourish, thrive, and prosper. Nothing wrong with starting small. Nothing wrong. Everybody starts small. But I prophesy, even though your beginning is small, come on, business leaders, your latter end shall greatly increase. Come on! And this is the promise for worshipers. This is the promise for the bride of Christ. Say, and all my children will be as before. That speaks of restoration in your children. And their congregation will be established before me. And I will punish all who oppress them. Of course God will. Why? Because if you mess with my wife, I'll switch on you. I'm a nice guy, but don't touch Lizzie. Come on, somebody. Well, we are the body of Christ. And when you're Christ's bride and people mess with you, they're messing with your husband. And you could mess with a lot of people, but don't mess with God. That's why some, I'll just leave it alone. Number four, I'm going to keep moving on. The church, say the church is a family. The church is a body for service and growth. The church is his bride. How many believe God blesses and protects his worshipers? Number four. The church is an army. I call it the city where warriors are raised. Warrior! Joel 3, 9, and 10. I love this verse. Proclaim this among the nations. See, the church needs to be international. Oh, yes. See, even though we have a great city in Los Angeles, it's a very segregated city sometimes. The browns stay with the browns, and the blacks with the blacks, and the browns and the whites with the whites and the yellows, and we all have our little communities, and we don't intermingle too much. But I told the Lord, we break that spirit. Come on, somebody. You ain't limiting me. You ain't holding me back. Oh, you don't like me right now. Come on, I break that spirit of racism. I break that spirit of limitation. Now, I fly all over the world, baby. I go to the UK and have tea in the afternoon. I'll go to New Zealand and kick back and eat me a lamb and watch the All Blacks. I'll go to Australia and watch footy matches. Come on, I'll go to Korea and eat me some good old sushi. Somebody ought to talk to you. I'll go down to Colombia, drink some coffee. Shout like you're international. That's the church of Jesus Christ. This is not a brown church, black church, white church, yellow church, red church. This is for every ethnicity. All nations shall call you the body of Christ. Tell your neighbor, take the limit off. Take the limit off. Take the limit off. Oh, oh Lord help me. No. Church is for everybody. Now, see, Pastor, but there's a lot of Hispanics here and a lot of blacks in your church. Yes, but there's also a lot of whites coming up and a lot of Asians coming up. And we need some Indians in here and some Ukrainians in here. Come on, and some Russians up in here. Somebody shout like we're going. I'm believing God. See, I'm believing God. That's part of our testimony. That's part of our light. That's part of how we shine in darkness. Because our society wants to segregate everybody and separate everybody by class and creed and race. But no, the church says, come as you are. Rich man, poor man, sick man, healthy man, black man, white man, brown, all come together. It's the casa de Dios. It is the house of God.
Proclaim this. Among the nations, prepare for war. Make disciples. Wake up the mighty men. Any mighty men here? What about the mighty women? Any mighty women in here? Oh, Lord. All the men are like, oh, my God. Any mighty warriors in here? Let all the men of war and women draw near. Let them come up. That's powerful. Say it with me. We're coming up. Everybody is going to come up. Everybody in every area of life. But this is how you're going to do it. Beat your plowshares. And that's like gardening tools. So this is talking about civilians into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. So that's a mentality. That's a mentality. That means every civilian is a soldier in the making. God wants to grow you up so you become a soldier. You don't start out as a soldier. You start out, you come in, you're hurting, you're broken, spiritually diseased, lame spiritually in many areas. But you get healed, you start volunteering, you get equipped, you get trained, and you become an army, a soldier in the army. And you start learning how to talk by faith. You stop talking depressed talk. You stop talking weak talk. You stop talking failure talk. You stop talking curse talk. You stop talking not enough talk. You start talking about going forward, taking territory, advancing, plundering hell and populated in heaven. You become a soldier. I like to say it this way. You become a disciple with a growth mentality. That's you cannot come to freedom and be part of this church and not develop a growth mentality. It will not happen. I'll frustrate you because every time I'm here, I'm going to be challenging you. Live holier. Love your wife more. Love your husband more. Be a better parent. Prosper in every area. Raise disciples. Multiply. Come on, I'm not going to let you stay stuck. I'm not going to let you get stagnant. That's religion. You have to have a growth mentality if you're going to be a soldier. The definition of true prosperity means to go forward. That means by this time next year, we should be able to say, man, you're healthier looking. You're better looking. Your marriage is better. You're a better husband. You're a better wife. You're a better parent. Wow, look at your business grew. Your leadership grew. Your influence. You got more followers. Come on, someone. Come on. Hey. You're dressing better. You're talking better. You're living better. Why? Because you're a soldier. You got a growth mentality. Not limited. Not pobre. Not barely making. Not what are we going to do? Not I don't have enough. No, you're talking about El Shaddai. The Almighty God is with you. Tell your neighbor, enlarge your house. Wrong neighbor, but tell him again, enlarge your house. Tell him God wants to give you a bigger house. Build an addition. Spread out your home. Spare no expense. You'll be bursting at the seams. Your children will occupy and resettle broken cities. That's what this is all about. We're not limiting. We're not limiting. I'm not a limited pastor. I was in Bogota at one of the greatest churches in the world. 100,000 members. And I was there. They want me to preach. That was a blessing. But I wanted to go learn. And I walked around all day Thursday. I said, we'll fly out on Friday. All day Thursday, me and Liz are just going to go from building to building and ask questions. Why? I have a growth mentality. I want to grow. God wants to do something greater in LA, greater in our region, greater in our families. I'm not going to limit God. Freedom, this is a huge event for us. We didn't have to do this big event, but this is growth mentality. Huh? Youth camp, this is a growth mentality. Prosperity conference, growth mentality. Come on now. We're not going to just sit back and let people go to hell. No, we're going to have a growth mentality. A disciple with a growth mentality. That's why God told Israel, he said, Moses, why are you crying to me? And Moses is like, well, Pharaoh is coming back to put us back in bondage, represents the world, the slavery of the world. To our left, there's mountains we cannot cross. To the right, there's mountains we cannot cross, and we can't go forward. There's a Red Sea. So it looks like what are we gonna do here? And God says, why are you crying to me? Question. There's a time to cry. There's a time where you come to Christ, and maybe for 6 months, even a year, it's time to get better. It's time to get healed. There's a time to cry. And some of you are gonna be crying for a while. It's called the abuse you went through, and the pain, the suffering, and the hurt, and the breakups, and all the divorces, and a lot of pain in the place, a lot of pain in the house of God. And it's okay, and you just cry and cry and cry. For the first year, I just cried like a baby. But then there comes a time where God says, okay, now dry your weary eye. It's time to pick up your sword, and it's time to fight for somebody else. And God is saying to somebody, stop crying. It's time to get up, and it's time to go forward. A growth mentality. If you're gonna have a growth mentality, understand hell is gonna try to oppress you. That's why I challenge a lot of you business leaders. You need to have a growth mentality. You have to get a purpose for your business. What's the purpose for my business? To prosper so I can have a better life? Yes, that's a blessing of God. But make it about kingdom. Make your business about destiny. And get a drive to say, I'm gonna fund the kingdom. I wanna give $1 million next year. I wanna give 500,000. I wanna give 25,000. Come on, you gotta have a growth mentality. And you're gonna step into spiritual warfare. You're gonna fight the devil because now your business, your career has a calling on it. It has purpose, it's connected. Don't disconnect your business from the house of God. They are connected. God needs you to prosper. God wants you to prosper. God needs you to come up. We gotta build more buildings. We gotta take more cities. We gotta save more souls. We gotta change more families. We gotta raise more disciples. Somebody ought to shout amen. Don't have a passive mentality at work. Don't have a get-by mentality. Next year at this time, I want to see you doing better in every area of your life. Come on, every area. You should be a little bit better by this time next year. If you had a career, you find out, how do I progress here at this job? If I can't progress here, Lord, where's my next job so I can progress? Don't stay stuck. Don't stay stagnant. Where can I progress here? Come on, I'm challenging you. Some of you don't like this. Because you don't want to face that fear, but you got to face that giant. You got to get the fist of faith. You got to grab the head of that Goliath, and you got to prosper like God wants you to prosper. I feel a shout in the room. Somebody ought to get excited. Glory to God. Glory to God. Matthew 16:18 says, I say you are Peter. He wasn't always Peter, was he? He was Simon the unstable. Watch me. Simon the unruly one. Are you an unruly one? You can't be a soldier being unruly. You got to be able to be led to lead. A lot of people want to be the boss, but you don't want anyone to boss you. You want everyone in your house to submit, but you don't want to submit to nobody. How's that going to flow? That don't work. Even the centurion knew, I'm a man in authority, but I'm a man under authority. Come on, I'm preaching to Simon. Where you at, Simon? Where you at, Simon? Simon the gifted. Simon the builder. Simon the talented. But Simon with the anger issue. The Simon who had a quit on God mentality. And Jesus comes up to him after his greatest failure in life. He walks up to him. He says, hey, 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 hey. You're not a Simon. You're a Peter. You're a Petro. And here he told him before his failure, he said, this is what you are. Even when you don't look like this, I'm going to call you what God says you are. I'm going to tell Simon, you're Peter. The weak say I'm strong. This is discipleship. He says, Simon, you know Simon, your name's going to be Peter. And upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Tell your neighbor, Jesus builds the church. And hell can't stop it. Jesus builds the church and hell can't stop it. Jesus builds the church and hell can't stop it. Jesus builds the church and hell can't stop it. Jesus builds the church and hell can't stop it. So guess what? I'm going to raise my marriage, my family, my finance, my business in church. I'm going to connect it to the church because if Jesus is building the church, he's building my business. He's building my marriage. He's building. Come on, son. Jesus builds the church. We don't just raise attenders. It's good to attend. That's the first level. You have to be a faithful attender. But after a while, you got to get planted and you got to grow and you got to get connected. And the same anointing that's in the house of God that slaps that devil upside the head, that takes cities, is the same anointing that will go in your marriage. It's the same anointing that will break the yoke off your children. It's the same anointing that will open doors no man can shut. It's the same anointing that will give you contract after building. Oh, somebody ought to shout like there is an anointing. I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. I will build my church. That's why it's for me, it's not, you know, they say you got to separate church and state. That's the problem. You can't separate it. You want a blessed family? You can't separate church and family. You want a blessed child? You can't separate church and family. You want financial breakthrough? You got to bring your tithe to the storehouse and watch God open the windows of heaven and pour out. Oh, I'll feel the anointing. Let God fight for your money. Devil, give me my money. July, I want my money. August, I want my money. Somebody ought to praise God like there's an anointing for increase. Some of you missed your chance to shout. Some of you are shocked. What's happening? I'll tell you what's happening. The anointing of God is in this place. I will build. Come on, elbow your neighbor and say, he will build. He will build. I will build my church. And the gates of hell. Please stand up. Please, if you're not standing, we're going to close. I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I will build my family in the house of God. I will raise my children in the house of God. I will connect my business to the house of God. I will connect my career to the house of God. I will serve God. I will honor God. Me and my, see this, aramashakayana. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Devil didn't want this message preached, but it's too late. We got it now. Somebody ought to give God praise. We're going to build what God builds. We're going to love what God loves. We're going to give to what God loves. Come on, shout like we love the house of God. La casa de Dios, the house of God. The gates of hell will not prevail. The gates of hell will not prevail. Hell wants to hold back families. Hell wants to hold back finance. Hell wants to hold back resource. Hell wants to hold back health. Hell wants to hold back opportunity. And hell has gates everywhere. You ain't getting in here. Your business ain't getting in here. Your career ain't getting in here. Your family ain't getting here. No, no. And hell wants to keep it back from your family. But when you're connected to the casa de Dios, come on, the gates of hell
the gate. We keep pushing, and we push, and we push, and we break through the gates of hell, and we take back what the enemy stole. Somebody shout like you're gonna take back. Give me my joy back. Give me my peace back. Give me my resource back. Give me my family back. Give me my finance back. Give me my health back. Take it back. Take it back. Take it back. Take it all back. Gates of hell.
Violent. There needs to be a violence to you. When it comes to loving people, there's a kindness. There's love, there's gentleness, there's patience, there's belief in people. But when it comes to dealing with the demonic, there's a violence to you. What do you mean you're not going to let my children serve God? What do you mean I'm not going to inherit the kingdom? What do you mean we're not going to the next level? And you can't just be passive. No, that's why you have to sit under this kind of apostolic anointing, and this thing will get on you, and this thing will have a shock on you, and you'll have an eye for the vision of heaven. I wish I could talk to somebody. I want to impart something right now. There needs to be a violence to you. I'm not going to settle for less than. I'm not going to live in Lodabar forever. Me and my family will break out of this poverty. I feel the glory of God. Say it. Say it.
I got to close.
The church, the city that God loves. Say, the church is a family. The church is a body. The church is a bride. The church is an army. And number five, the church is a hospital for the hurting, where curses are broken and generational blessings begin. Come on. Come on, clap like you're gonna break the curse. Clap, clap. That's why the devil fought you to get here. That's why he fought you so long, so hard to get here. Some of you were mad at the church. You don't even know why. Because the devil put anger in the church in your heart. Because he knew once you stepped into the casa de Dios, the house of God, the curse would be broken, right? And the blessing would begin to flow in your genealogy. It will say curse, 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 curse. Casa de Dios, blessed. Bless. Come on, somebody, act like you got a blessing.
I gotta close.
And you will rebuild the ancient ruins, and you will raise up the former desolation, and you will repair the ruined cities, the desolation of many generations. Seems like our inner cities are broken right now. Seems like the inner cities have been ravished. It seems like the inner cities of our nation have been, there's murder and gangs and violence and poverty. Seems like there's no hope. Even churches are leaving the cities of America. But God said to me clearly, you ain't running from you're not gonna run from the violence. I built you to run into the violence. Somebody act like we've been built different. Somebody clap like we've been built different. So we go into the cities and we begin to develop and build and break curses off people. And you come back, so what happened to Anna? She used to be this way. Oh, she started going to that church over there. Man, she don't want to party like she used to party. She ain't wild like she used to. What? She ain't dressing like she. What's going on? The curse was broken, and the blessings have been released. So freedom. Praise him if you're gonna praise him. Don't patty cake. So go out, freedom, quickly. Go into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in here the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind, the unwanted, the orphan. And the servant said, Master, we did it, but there's still room. And the master said, oh yeah, now go out into the highway and hedges and compel them to come in that my house may be full. What does it say? It says, pain comes in every form. Doesn't care what color your skin is, doesn't care your background, doesn't care how much money you have or don't have. And God says, you bring the hurting from the poor and the whole and with the broken, and then you go up to the highway and byway. You go to the upper class, the middle class, and the lower class, and every other class, you bring them into my house. And I'm gonna fill this place, and I'm gonna change their lives forever. Because the church is a hospital. Come on, somebody, for the hurting. I said, the church is a hospital for the hurting, and I close. You're gonna help me close. Tell your neighbor, freedom. Build a road for your returning people. Prepare a highway. Clear out the stones. Put a sign up so that all nations, every ethnic group, every economic background can know that the Lord is announcing to all the earth, and then tell the people that the Lord is coming to save them. And he's bringing with him the people like me and you. He has already rescued. What is he saying? He's saying, tell them, if God did it for me, tell your neighbor, if God did it for me, he's gonna do it for you. He's gonna do it for your family. He's gonna do it for your friends. He's gonna do it for your city. If God did it for me, ha, 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 if God. And tell him, hey, you will be called God's holy people. People the Lord saved. And tell him, you will be called the city that God loves. How many love? How many believe you're going to another level? Do me a favor. Tell three people around you, you're going to another level. You're going from faith to faith, from glory to glory, from wealth to wealth, from health to health. You're not getting weaker, you're getting stronger. We go. We go. Forgive us for not honoring what you honor. We honor your house. This is the city you love. And Lord, in this house, my family will be blessed and raised. In this house, I will serve you with my gifts. In this house, we will grow and multiply. And I will worship in this house and at my house. And worship won't be a religion, but it will be my lifestyle. I renounce out of my life a spirit of religion. I renounce it now in Jesus' name. I am a worshiper. I am the bride of Christ. I diligently seek God. Therefore, I prosper in every area because me and my house are planted in your house. And Lord, I renounce the spirit of fear in my life. I decree and declare limitation, intimidation, and discouragement is forever broken off my life. Get out of my house, get out of my life, and get out of my body. I decree and declare, I go forward with the blessing of Abraham. And in Jesus' name, my family, my friends, my world shall be saved. If you believe it, give God one more shout. We go. Testify, I'll never be the same again. Some of you got water baptized. You'll never be the same again. Glory to God. We go from glory.